Welcome to Seasoned. I'm Marisol Castro.
And I'm Chef Plum. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Depending on when you're listening to this, you're either about to eat, you've already eaten, or Thanksgiving 2020 is in the books and you're making your way through piles of leftover turkey and stuffing and cranberry sauce. Well, we've got some ideas for you.
Coming up on the show, Alex Beggs is the Emily Post for these odd times we're living in. We'll get advice from Bon Appétit magazine's Etiquette columnist about navigating the holidays during a pandemic and beyond.
We'll also talk to Craig Wright of Craig's Kitchen in Vernon. This is Craig's third year serving his community Thanksgiving dinner for free.
And what's it like being a turkey farmer? In a few minutes, you'll hear our conversation with Rick Hermonot of Ekonk Hill Turkey Farm. But first, what to do with all those leftovers?
What do you think you have left over the most, Marisol, like after Thanksgiving? What do you think is the...
Definitely turkey.
The turkey.
Turkey and dry stuffing.
Is there anything worse than dry stuffing after the fact? Ugh, it's really rough.
No.
Here at my house, I fry my turkey. I think it just makes it taste so much better. But it's funny because every year someone also brings a roast turkey as well. So we end up with two turkeys. And
turkey two ways.
It's a lot of turkey. And, you know, there's only so many turkey sandwiches you can make in your life. For me, I can eat about seven of them Thanksgiving night. And then after that, it's usually one a day.
You're
for
done.
A couple of days.
After one turkey sandwich, I'm done.
Is that it? I got to have stuffing. I've got to have mayo. I've got to have black pepper and some kind of crunchy lettuce. If you don't have that, you're doing it all wrong.
Crunchy lettuce is good, yeah.
You know, one of my favorite things to actually make with all these leftovers, I love to make these awesome empanadas using... It works pretty well. I mean, listen, you can do it so simply too. And, you know, you think empanada, you think the dough is probably the hardest part to make, right?
Yes, I would think, yes.
I like to use puff pastry dough pre-bought from the store.
In a Puerto Rican household, that would never fly, but continue with your blasphemy.
I know. But here's the thing. And like, normally I would totally agree with you, but you just got done making a massive Thanksgiving dinner. It's okay to take a shortcut.
All right, fine.
But what I'll do is I'll take the puff pastry dough and basically I'll roll it out so it's about 35% bigger or so, a little bit of, you know, AP flour down, roll it out. And then I cut it into four squares. And these empanadas almost become like a meal in themselves. You can stuff whatever you want in them. I stuff turkey. I stuff stuffing or dressing, whichever wherever you come from, I guess. Green beans, if you chop the green beans up and throw them in there. The trick is when you fold them over, you want to refold them on top of themselves
right.
on yeah, the very yeah, yeah. end. So you kind of, I fold them over like the triangle sides, you know what I'm saying? So I take one corner to the other after I stuff it, put the stuff in the middle, fold it over.
Oh, yeah.
And then I leave about a quarter inch or so of lip, I guess, on the bottom of it. So it doesn't fold perfectly over. And then I refold itself on top of that. Then you can take a fork and press down those edges so they look, you know, nice and crimped. You can trim it up a little bit with a knife or with a pizza cutter if you want as well. But then you want to brush it with some egg wash. Take an egg, just whip an egg up, a little bit of milk, a little bit of water in there, mix it up.
Mm-hmm.
The key, most important thing when doing these, you got to put a little vent dot inside of it. So take a knife and put a little tiny hole on top
of it. So the steam can escape.
If you don't, trust me, it still escapes. It just escapes all over the oven. Not good times. That's one of my go-tos.
What else do you do after empanadas? What else? Give me two more things you do.
I came up with this whole idea. Because where I come from down south, you know, where I grew up, we would make chicken and dumplings all the time. And I said, how can I make leftovers into like a turkey stew and dumpling situation? Well, here's what I came up with. So, again, I've been cooking all day, so I'm taking shortcuts the next day. Okay, I'm sorry. You guys can judge me all you want.
Please.
It's fine. I'll go and buy a little pack of like, you know, those little tubes of biscuit dough.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
The things that pop when you hit it and you can scare your kids with it.
Yeah. You bang them on the table. Yeah.
Perfect. I'll take a big pot. I will then take all the things I have, stuffing, turkey. I try to keep cranberry sauce out of it. I've done it. It adds a little too much sweetness to it. Green beans we'll chop up and throw in there too.
Mm-hmm.
And then I take gravy and pour whatever leftover gelatinous gravy we have left. Add a little bit of water or stock to it. Mix it up so it becomes a nice, thick, hearty stew. Pour that into a casserole pan. You know,
a casserole pan.
Or if you have any leftover foil pans, that's what I like to use, those half foil pans during Thanksgiving time because there's less dishes. Take those biscuits that you got, those little tube of biscuits, break them up and put them on top of that stew, brush it with melted butter, put it in the oven. This is the best reuse of Thanksgiving leftovers you'll ever have. It comes out one big casserole dish where there's buttery biscuits all over the top of it. That delicious mixture of all those Thanksgiving flavors. It goes so well together. And having that biscuit, oh my gosh, makes me so happy.
I'm going to have to ask for extra leftovers from my sister just so I can make that. All right, one last thing to tell me about what you do with your leftovers.
Everyone makes turkey soup, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to do turkey soup. We've talked about that. We've talked about turkey sandwiches. We even talked about turkey empanadas. Let's go crazy and do something even weirder with all of this stuff. Save some of that turkey and let's make a beautiful turkey pasta dish. So what we're going to do is we're going to make essentially, I don't want to say tetrazzini, or the way I normally do it is almost like a stroganoff situation. I'll use egg noodles, a little heavy cream, Parmesan cheese, bring that to a small simmer in a pan, add one egg yolk, mm-hmm. take it off the heat, add the egg yolk and mix it. It's a little bit more difficult, but actually the technical term of that is called lyonnaise. Yeah, you know, fancy. Then what I'll do is I will take a pan and get some hot water going and then boil off just some broccoli. Then I'll take my pasta that I cooked, those egg noodles, I'll mix it in with that sauce and I'll shred up the turkey, throw it in there as well. Toss that broccoli in there, toss the whole thing in a pan and serve it right on a plate. It's beautiful. It's almost like a take on a stroganoff or take on an Alfredo sauce. It's so delicious, so easy. The key ingredient here, black pepper. Finish it with fresh cracked black pepper. It's delicious and you'll never look at turkey the same again.
It sounds absolutely delicious. I have a feeling I'm going to be very busy in the kitchen.
Hey, there's so many things you could do. You could also do taco night the next night and use turkey tacos. I mean, you got me going. I can go all day.
Tacos for days. Turkey tacos.
Come
days.
On, turkey pizzas? We can make pizzas with turkey. I got a million of them. Because like I said, we always end up with two turkeys at our house.
Now I know why. You need all the extra turkey for the leftovers.
That's right.
But you know, during the lead up to Thanksgiving, we thought it would be fun to talk to turkey farmer Rick Hermonot of Ekonk Hill Turkey Farm about life on the farm for Rick and his birds. We spoke back in October about how Rick got started in farming and how wonderfully curious and sometimes mischievous Rick's turkeys can be.
Well, we're located in Sterling, Connecticut. We've got 360 acres that we farm. Our primary product is turkeys, but we also raise beef, lamb, pork, and hay on the acreage of our farm. And we raise all our livestock on pasture and grass-fed. So that's kind of our niche. Our turkeys this year, we have about 4,000.
Wow.
They do have a coop they can go in. They have pasture that they can roam on and forage. Turkeys love to forage, so they love having green grass and bugs to chase and whatnot.
So they're not just cramped. They're out and about living the free life.
They're out and about. In fact, one of the folks think, well, your turkeys are eating grass, so you don't have to feed them as much grain. But we actually use our rate of gain. It takes about 4 pounds of feed to get a pound of turkey, whereas our counterparts who raise them in confinement, you know, the large commercial farms only use 2 pounds of feed to get a pound of turkey. That's because our birds are running around getting a lot of exercise, burning off a lot of calories, so it takes a lot more feed to grow them.
4,000 turkeys, that's got to be a ton of feed. I'm reading here, you guys, when you first started doing this, you raised 15 turkeys for family and friends, and then now it's 4,000. That is quite an undertaking to go from a small amount to a large amount like that. It seems rather quickly, too.
Yeah, it's been over about a 10 or 12 year period that we grew that much. We've been at this level for a couple of years now, but the big workload is coming.
Yeah.
We process them all right on our farm, so we've got an incredible amount of work ahead of us here in the next few weeks.
Yeah, I'm guessing this is your busy season. I'm going to go out on a limb and guess that this is the busy season.
Yes.
Start from the beginning. How did you become a turkey farmer? Was this something that your family did? Did you wake up one morning and say, you know what? I'm going to be a turkey farmer.
Well, it's funny. It goes all the way back to when I was a kid. I grew up in suburban Connecticut. My mom was a mail lady. My dad was an industrial engineer for Uniroyal. We had no farming in our background. But as a kid, I had a dream of being a farmer. And I went to Voag High School in Woodbury, Connecticut, was a member of the FFA, and had an interest in poultry back then as a kid. And I actually won the poultry judging contest with the state of Connecticut, which sent me to the nationals.
All right.
So it started way back then. FFA, I give a plug to them. They are an outstanding organization, teach leadership skills, public speaking skills to young people. Last I knew, they were the largest youth organization in the world. I was fortunate enough to go through the FFA, and that really kindled my passion for being in agriculture and getting into poultry eventually. We started out, though, my wife and I and my brother, we rented a dairy farm in Middlebury. We milked a couple hundred cows. And over time, we transitioned to turkeys, not because we didn't like being dairy farmers, but because we wanted to get into retail. And the thought of trying to bottle milk and put up a bottling plant was daunting. And we had this passion for turkeys. And that's when we were raising a handful and people were asking us. So we just started raising more and more turkeys. And then we got out of the dairy business and we're doing the turkeys full time.
Tell us a little bit about the day in the life of a turkey farmer.
It varies a lot. I mean, early on, we're tending to the babies in the brooder house. And then when they're moved out onto pasture, the workload changes quite a bit. We're filling large feeders. There is no typical day. And it's one of the things I love about raising turkeys as opposed to being a dairy farmer. When I was a dairy farmer, I get up every day at 4 a.m., milk the cows, fed the calves, fed the cows, cleaned the barn, then did it all over again at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, then did it all again at 4 a.m. the next morning. Whereas as a turkey farmer, some days I spend fixing fence, building fence for the turkeys. We feed them now when they're this old. We have these feeders that hold 3 days worth of feeds. We have to tend to them, add bedding to the barn, check on them, clean the waterers, things like that. But it's not as routine as life was as a dairy farmer. It's a little more unique every day.
I got to imagine that turkeys are just ornery animal. That's the best way I would say. Growing up, my mom would say something is ornery if it was, you know, had a little attitude, if it was hard to get along with. I got to imagine turkeys are a little ornery. They're loud, you know.
Well, turkeys, a lot of people who come to our farm think turkeys are stupid. That's the first question they ask. Aren't they a dumb animal? And turkeys actually have incredible curiosity. Whenever we're working in the field, in the pasture, or in the barn, they all gather around. They're looking to see what we're doing. One time I was working on putting some waterers up, and I had these little hooks that I was going to be using, and I had a dozen of them. I put them down on the shelf in the barn there. The turkeys came over, and all 12 of the hooks got stolen by a turkey. And they were running around the
barn. They were saving themselves.
I was able to get them all back because the one that had the hook, there were about 30 or 40 turkeys chasing that one, trying to steal it from them. And so there were a dozen turkeys running around the coop with a pack of turkeys running behind it trying to steal the hook from it. So I was able to find all the culprits and get the hooks back because I needed them for what I was doing. But they will come and gather around you and crane their necks and look at you, and they will pick at your boots and peck at you just out of curiosity. They're very curious, very social birds. I wouldn't call them ornery. They're just very curious. They'll get in the way if you're trying to work in the pasture or in the barn because they gather around, get underfoot. You can hardly walk. Curiosity gets them in trouble. They say curiosity killed the cat. I would say more so curiosity killed the turkey because they will go to something that's causing a danger to them just because you're curious. They want to check it out.
Right. I can't blame them. So you set up that scene. Have you or your family ever gotten attached to your turkeys? Because see, I love meat, protein, things that were once alive. It pains me to think about them having a personality because, you know, I'm going to devour it. So do you have relationships with these turkeys? How do you delineate between being the farmer and being a businessman?
When my daughter, who is now our marketing manager, and she's very involved with the turkey enterprise, when she was 6 or 7 or 8 years old, and we were only raising that 15 turkeys for Thanksgiving, she refused to come to the table one year because eating the turkeys that she had become friends with as we were raising them. She's since outgrown that. We do have an affection for all the animals we raise. We enjoy working with them. We wouldn't be in this business if we didn't have an affection for the animals, the birds, and the livestock. But we do have to realize that they're being raised for a purpose, that we give them a really good life. We process them on the farm, and we do it in a very humane way so that the birds don't experience any stress. Being on a farm and growing up on a farm, our children have all learned that, and it's just the way it is.
Have you ever been encouraged by any of your children or your family members to pardon a turkey every year?
Last November, the lieutenant governor came out and pardoned a turkey at our farm.
I picture him having like a whole court set up for him where
and my this goodness. Turkey.
So yeah, we literally have had turkeys pardoned.
Now, Rick, did you file an appeal after that? Did you file an appeal?
And my daughter, when she was younger, she used to pardon turkeys. She would move a bird into a pen and put a sign on it. This is Katie's turkey. Do not touch it. And she was she's a young lady you don't argue with. So. And we had one for 14 years, one turkey that she had pardoned.
Wow.
She took it into the Children's Museum in Hartford one time, put it on display, strutted, and did quite a nice show for the kids who came through just to learn about. That was one of her FFA projects when she was in Future Farmers of America.
What's life on Ekonk Hill Turkey Farm? What's life for a turkey like on the farm?
Well, they start out in April through July in our brooder house, which is a brooder that keeps the temperature at about 95 to 100 degrees, and we gradually lower the temp as they grow. And then by the time they're 4 or 5 weeks old, it's summer weather, that time of year when we're starting our turkeys. So by 5 weeks of age, usually, unless the weather is not cooperating, but usually it does, they get moved out into our main growing barn, which is where the pasture is. They'll stay in there for a couple of weeks, then they'll get turned out to access the pasture when they're about 6 to 7 weeks old. And after that, they just eat and forage. They have grain available to them full time and feeders in the barn, and water is available full time, obviously, in the barn. And then they have pasture that they can forage on, eat grass, eat bugs, find things to run around. And they're just curious, playful animals. They'll constantly be finding something and then have a group of birds chasing after them, trying to figure out what it is they have. And it may just be a twig or a leaf or something, but they really do enjoy foraging. By nature, they love to forage and look for things to eat, and they seem to get a lot of enjoyment out of foraging.
That is fascinating to me. You know, here in the state of Connecticut, we hear stories of dairy farms. I've recently learned that there are some cows that live a better life than I do. They're sleeping on Tempur-Pedics. It's a whole situation. Are your turkeys living the good life? Are you like feeding them chocolate bonbons?
Well, I would definitely say they're living the good life, primarily because they have access to the outdoors. They get, you know, full access to feed, as I mentioned, in the barn, in the coop, where they can eat whenever they want to. But they also have the opportunity to forage and roam around. And that's what they, by nature, enjoy doing. So, yes, I'd say they're living the good life.
Let's get down to turkey tax here. Let's talk about farm fresh turkeys in the cooking process versus getting, you know, something people might buy from the supermarket. What are some tips you would give people to cook fresh farm-raised turkey as opposed to, you know, the frozen store-bought ones?
Well, one of the differences of a fresh turkey is they cook much faster. And folks who've never cooked a fresh turkey don't realize that. The moisture level of the meat is so much higher than a bird that's been frozen the heat transfers through the meat much more quickly, and they cook much, much faster. Typical recommendation is 15 to 20 minutes a pound for a frozen bird. Ours will cook in 12 minutes a pound, typically. Of course, we always recommend a meat thermometer to measure when they're done, because ovens all tend to vary. But at 325, 12 minutes a pound, and they're usually done. Even folks who get the huge birds from us, the 35 to 40 pounders, they're amazed at how quickly they cook. They think, oh my God, I'm going to cook these for a day and a half. But it's not so with a fresh turkey. They cook faster. And so the biggest mistake folks make is they overcook them.
Yeah, I agree.
If it's the first time doing a fresh bird.
Do the people who come get turkeys from you, do they pick out their turkey? How does this work?
We did have a...
Because I don't want to get too attached.
Well, you know, the chosen cut Christmas tree, we had a grandmother show up with her grandchildren one, this was a few years ago, and wanted to tag her turkey. This was in October, well before Thanksgiving. She wanted to go out with the kids and pick a turkey and put their name on it so that Thanksgiving, that would be the turkey they were having. I explained to her that that wouldn't be possible, not in front of the kids, but I just told her, well, we can't really track that turkey to you later. You can come out and pick out a turkey and then come back and get a turkey at Thanksgiving. The kids enjoyed it. I was a little bizarre request, a little different, but we accommodated her. She took the kids out to the pasture, mm-hmm. and they picked out a turkey and said, well, that's going to be our dinner for Thanksgiving. And then they came and got a turkey at Thanksgiving. But no, the normal process is folks just either call or email or visit the farm. They state what size they'd like. And we come as close as possible to the size they ask for. That's actually the biggest stress for us at Thanksgiving, is hitting the right size. As a small farm, we only have a limited number of turkeys, mm-hmm. and we have customers for almost all of the turkeys. So we need to match the customer and the size. And we don't have an inventory list ahead of time saying we have this many 15 pounders, this many 18 pounders, and so forth. We have to kind of guess because they're still running around the pasture growing. And so it's a bit of an art to getting those birds and those customers matched perfectly. Some years we nail it. Some years it gets skewed and we have to adjust accordingly. But
and you never know when you promised the 22-pound Tom, the last one, to somebody, and the lieutenant governor shows up and pardons them. And then what are you going to do then?
Right.
That art Rick described of the farmer trying to time out the weight of the turkeys to match the desires of families who will be buying and eating them, it made us wonder how Rick was planning for this Thanksgiving, when many people will be cooking for their immediate family of 4 or 5 instead of 8 or 10 or 20. We wondered, were people requesting much smaller birds this year than in previous years?
Yeah, we're already seeing that. We've got a lot of orders right now. The phone rings off the hook, people calling to place orders, and we enter them into a spreadsheet so that when they come and pick up, we have an organized system for tracking it. And so we're able to look at what our orders are. And so far, they're running about 3 pounds below average, the average size, which makes me a little nervous because the turkeys are going to grow the way the turkeys grow, and they're going to be what they are. We can't control that. So if we get a lot of smaller orders, we may run out of smaller birds.
This just reminded me, you know, when my children were younger, we had to stop in the middle of traffic because there was a flock. Is it a flock of turkeys?
Flock, yep.
A flock of turkeys crossing the street. And I was, you know, honking my horn. I'm like, I got to get to point B. And, you know, my son is like, let them cross. That might be our Thanksgiving dinner. And I was like, no, those are wild turkeys. So can you delineate between wild turkeys that I see crossing the street, that I see frequently, versus the turkeys you have in your farm? I did not break my son's heart, right? It's not like I could have gotten that turkey and, you know, that turkey would have been our Thanksgiving dinner, correct?
Well, wild, we do raise heritage turkeys on our farm as well as the traditional broad-breasted white. And the heritage turkey is much more like a wild turkey. So we do sell some that are very similar to a wild turkey, which means they have very little breast meat, not a lot of white meat. They're mostly dark meat. They're not quite as juicy and tender, but they're more flavorful. And some folks really, really like them. We charge $12 a pound for our heritage, and we've been sold out for over a month already on those.
Already?
Wow.
So they're a niche item. They're kind of like the heirloom tomato of the turkey world. And they're very similar to a wild turkey that you saw crossing the road. But most folks like the whites better because they're juicier, they're more tender, lots of white meat. Most people like the white meat better. And that's why the broad-breasted white turkey is raised for consumers, because it meets what their expectation is.
I got to be honest, I'm a chef. I like those niche items. I just got very excited. I was like, oh my gosh, I can get a heritage bird from this guy. This is amazing. I was getting very excited. And then Rick, you know what you did? You took my legs out from underneath me and said, nope, we're sold out.
Oh yeah, that part.
Order in August.
Really?
Order one in August and you'll get one. Otherwise, you're pretty well sold out.
That far ahead of time, huh? That's amazing. I'm glad to know that now. Because
people start calling in August. And usually it's first or second week of September we'll be sold out of heritage.
Rick, are you a dark meat or white meat?
I prefer dark meat.
Me too.
But oddly enough, I like the dark meat. I like the dark meat on a white bird, on the broad-breasted white. It's so juicy, so melt-in-your-mouth tender. The heritage have a little less tenderness to them, so I'm not as fond of the dark meat on a heritage.
Well, Plum, since he's out of heritage, I'm just going to co-sign with him.
You're doing that, huh?
Yeah.
Listen, I gotta ask you though, Rick. By the time Thanksgiving Day rolls around for you, are you so over turkey that you're like, you know what, we're having steak tonight?
No, we always have turkey. I never get tired of eating it, so we do have turkey for Thanksgiving.
Rick, you're the best. We appreciate you. We hope you have a great Thanksgiving with your family and a great season. And we look forward to talking to you on down the road.
You too. Thank you. Have a great day.
That was Rick Hermonot, owner of Ekonk Hill Turkey Farm in Sterling, Connecticut. Later on in the hour, Alex Beggs, the etiquette columnist from Bon Appetit magazine, helps us decipher what's acceptable in this new normal.
And coming up after the break, a conversation with hometown hero Craig Wright, owner of Craig's Kitchen in Vernon.
You have to learn from your errors, you know, try to make them better. Not just cooking, but life itself.
I'm Marisol Castro.
And I'm Chef Plum. You're listening to Seasoned. We'll be right back after the break.
Welcome back, everybody. This is Seasoned. I'm Marisol Castro.
And I'm Chef Plum. You're about to meet a very special chef. Craig Wright owns Craig's Kitchen in Vernon. Craig's specialty is soul food. You'll find fried, barbecued, and smothered chicken on the menu, as well as ribs, catfish, collard greens, candied yams, mac and cheese, and red beans and rice. Soul food is comfort food. And since 2018, Craig has been bringing comfort food to the people of Vernon on Thanksgiving Day for free.
Craig's is a story of hardship, grit, determination, and giving back. We spoke with Craig earlier this month.
We asked what led him to Connecticut, the turns his life took once he got here, and how he learned to cook.
I was born and raised in Detroit, Michigan, and I moved to Connecticut 2002, 2003. So I was around like 15 years old. My mother had passed away when I was young. So I spent a lot of years moving from family to family, and I ended up living with an aunt that took a shot and came out here to Connecticut.
I grew up down south, and at Craig's, you do soul food, which is one of the most delicious styles of food on the planet. But when I hear you're from Michigan, I get worried. You're making soul food in Michigan? Where'd that come from?
How is that even possible? Because you gotta understand, I'm from Detroit, and just the city of Detroit itself has like deep Southern roots from over the 1900s. There was a big migration from families from the South up to the North, specifically like Detroit, to work inside like the motor factories. So there's a deep Southern heritage in Detroit. So don't sleep on my head. Don't try to play me. Don't try to disrespect me.
No disrespect intended. Just I gotta check, man. I gotta check. I see soul food and you know.
Motor City.
Yeah, definitely Motor City representing. You should know firsthand. You gotta try it. You just can't knock it. Don't knock it till you try it.
100%. And once you try good soul food, there's no coming back. That's for sure.
Well, I'll tell you, man. Let me tell you one thing about the good soul food. It took me years to really develop into the chef that I am right now. Like, I'm sure you know, trial and error is huge.
Huge. I'm still in the error part. I'm still.
Me too. You have to learn from your errors and try to make them better. Not just cooking, but life itself.
I was just going to say, it's interesting that you say that, because before we get into your food background and your passion for food, you are no stranger to adversity. And I wonder if you can tell us about the times in your life that transformed you and motivated you to find and reach new levels in your life so that you could be where you are today.
When I had moved to Connecticut, I was a complete knucklehead. I dropped out of school and I wanted to party all the time. Just made completely wrong decisions. I sold drugs and got caught up. I was in and out of prison basically from the age of 18 to 25. I was in and out of prison. If I wasn't in prison, I was on probation or parole or some kind of supervision. I was in prison for 3 years. And then the remaining 6 months I spent in a halfway house. But that 3 years in prison like changed my life. And it was really the most important and biggest thing that had happened to me, because that was the switch that clicked, that put everything into perspective. The things that I thought that were important really wasn't important. And I saw that. And the people that were important, like my family and the friends that cared, those were the important ones, because when I was at my lowest, they were the ones that wanted to support me and were there. So that was one big thing. Like, prison, I'm tearing up and everything right now. Like,
oh man. Well, listen, that's one big thing. That's a massive big thing right there.
Like, I tell you, man, like that prison, that swift kick in the butt was really what I needed. And like, when I got that big time and I sat down for that 3 years, that's when I was like, all right, we can't do this anymore, because you got to break the cycle. And then so I went to that halfway house for that 6 months. And when I was there, I ended up getting a job in a kitchen, started washing dishes there. And basically from when I got out of the halfway house up until I opened Craig's Kitchen, it was a period of like, 4 years. Whereas it was a time where I had four separate jobs all at once. I was a cook at a daycare. I was cooking at another restaurant. Like, I was all over the place, but like trying to save my money up just every day. Like, I woke up and I wake up every day making the decision that I'm going to do better. And that's what you have to do. You got to do it every day. Every day I try to be better. Every day.
You were like a life coach before a life coach became a popular thing. It sounds like it.
Because I've really lived it. Like, I've been rock bottom. Like, I've literally slept in, like, like I have slept outside so many times. Like, I'm so sorry.
Listen, it's okay. It's an amazing story, and it's very, very inspiring to everybody when I hear it. Honestly, to see what you've gone through and what you've accomplished, and we're going to talk about what you're doing now to help, is amazing.
I'm so sorry. I'm getting emotional.
Emotion is good. These are the things that make you who you are, man.
They say when you feel something in its totality, it's because it's your calling. So being in prison clearly wasn't your calling. Being a drug dealer clearly wasn't your calling. But doing the work that you're doing now is your calling. And I have a question. When you were in the halfway house and you became a dishwasher, how did you get that job? Did they just say, Craig, this is your job? Or did you go into the want ads? How did you? Because that one decision really was like a turning point.
I found that job on Craigslist.
Stop it.
It was like, so basically when we were in the halfway house, we got like day passes to go search for jobs. So there were like job resource places, because this was in Hartford. And I found a job on Craigslist, straight like that. I knew like it would be hard for me because I'm a felon. So that bars me from doing certain things. But getting into the kitchens and cooking and dishwashing, that I knew that that would be easy for me to get into, basically. But I tell you, when I was in prison and it just when my whole thought process was changing, I knew I wanted to own a business. So that's why I was like, okay, I'm going to get into the kitchen and I'm just going to put 110% into that. And that's what I did.
Had anyone taught you how to cook? Do you have memories growing up of a family members cooking a specific dish or watching someone in your family cook?
I was the youngest of four boys. My mother raised all of us. Up until she passed away, I was like her helper, you know?
Craig, I was looking at the menu online for Craig's, and I got a little excited about it. And if a man's gonna run a soul food restaurant, I gotta ask him about his collard greens. Talk us through your collard greens, man.
Why you said you want my secrets, man? Come on, you're gonna give me everything? I can't give you all my secrets now. Hey, he just want everything. Okay, I definitely use smoked meat. That's about all I can give you.
Okay, that works for me. I definitely would use a little smoked ham hock when I make mine as well.
But the thing is, I gotta use the turkey meat because of a lot of people don't eat pork, so I gotta make everyone happy.
There we go.
I prefer the pork personally, but
that's what I'm looking for.
Where did you get your recipes from?
Like I said, I grew up cooking with my mother, so a lot of the things I knew and I've always done, like, it's just natural to me. But going back to me saying trial and error, because a lot of the things, like, I taught myself, and I failed until it got right.
Craig was inspired to serve free Thanksgiving dinners back in 2018. The restaurant had been robbed, and the community rallied around him, holding a Craig's Day to support the restaurant.
So they basically came, a lot of people came, ate at the restaurant, and at the same time, they had a little donation thing, whereas the donations were to go to my security system. I appreciated them coming to the restaurant, but I really didn't want like those donations because I just didn't really feel right taking the donations. So I ended up taking the donations and I gave it to the local vet house. But at the same time, that really meant a lot to me that they came together and did that for me. So I figured like I had to do something for the community since they did it something for me, like, which they really didn't have to do. So it was a few months from Thanksgiving and I was like, hey, why don't I just do this? Like, cause it's different. No one else has ever done this before. I'll just do a Thanksgiving dinner for the town. Like, I'm just going to do it every year as long as I'm open now.
That's amazing, man. What a fantastic story for that to spawn from. Has it grown like since the first one you did? Did you serve 10 people? Then now you're serving 50 people. How much has it grown in the years you've been doing it?
I tell you, it's definitely grown a lot, especially this year with COVID. In our area, like, there's a lot of people without jobs, and this will definitely help a lot of people financially. It's a hard time right now.
Unbelievably hard.
So with that, I feel it's definitely bigger this time. And just because we're more recognized with it, because we've done it, and people know, and they expect it, you know, so it's definitely more of a big deal this time around.
What are some of the things on the menu this year?
This year, we start with the turkey. We're going to have baked turkey, and we're going to have jerk turkey. And then we're going to have fried chicken. And then we're going to have some ham as well, some like honey glazed ham. And then we're going to have mac and cheese, some collard greens, some green beans, candy yams, some dressing. I don't know if you call it stuffing. We call it dressing where I'm from. I don't know about you.
I call it dressing too. I call it dressing also, and my family thinks I'm crazy.
Well, I probably call it dressing. Okay, so we have some of that little rice, some red beans and rice. And on top of that, have so many volunteers and so many people donating dishes and desserts. Like, it's going to be amazing.
I know the town is very lucky to have you, and we're lucky to have you here in Connecticut and to be able to do these type of things to give back. I mean, it's just, it's got to be just the feeling for you has got to be incredible.
I mean, yeah, just because, like I said, it's been a long road. Mm-hmm. It's been a very long road. And I'm 33 years old. Like, I have my whole life ahead of me.
Just getting started.
That's it. Like, yeah, it just started.
How about a couple of shout-outs to some volunteers or people that help you, or shout-out some people who are donating?
I'll give a whole shout-out to the town of Rockville, Vernon. Vernon, shout-out, because I love them. I love the whole Tallin County. I love the whole Connecticut. Connecticut.
He loves the whole Connecticut.
The whole Connecticut. Yeah, everyone. Wow. Thank you.
Craig, you're amazing. You guys, if you haven't done so, check out Craig's. It's a fantastic soul food restaurant. But just don't ask him how he makes his collards. He doesn't want to tell you that.
Don't ask me. I try to get nobody none of my secrets. So please don't ask.
Hey, I got the turkey out of you. I got something out of you.
Yeah, all right.
Craig, we appreciate your time, man. Thank you so, so much.
Hey, I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
Happy Thanksgiving, brother.
All right, you too.
That was Craig Wright, owner of Craig's Kitchen in Vernon. To say this is a tough time for small local restaurants like Craig's is an understatement. It's more important than ever that we support our neighborhood shops and cooks like Craig so they can continue feeding their communities and giving back in the best ways they know how. We're rooting for you, Craig. Have you heard an inspiring story about someone doing something amazing with food in your community? Share it with us. Send an email to seasoned@ctpublic.org.
After the break, Etiquette columnist Alex Beggs talks with us about celebrating the holidays over Zoom and all the things you can do instead of attending a large gathering this year.
You could light a pumpkin spice candle and summon your ancestors. I've once spent a Thanksgiving watching all of the Friends Thanksgiving episodes. It was time really well spent.
I'm Marisol Castro.
And I'm Chef Plum. You're listening to the Thanksgiving episode of Seasoned. We'll be right back after the break.
Welcome back to Seasoned. I'm Marisol Castro.
And I'm Chef Plum.
I think we can all agree this is likely the wonkiest holiday season most of us will ever experience, and we could use some help navigating it all.
Alex Beggs is a senior staff writer at Bon Appétit magazine. She writes a column called Is It Ever Okay?, where she answers readers' burning questions about bad manners and more. You'll hear me throw out some scenarios to her.
Alex Beggs, it is such a privilege and an honor to finally see your face after reading your column for all these months. Thank you for doing this with us.
Thank you for having me.
This is not the Emily Post etiquette column that our forefathers and foremothers grew up with. This is the very witty, charming answer to what is appropriate when dining out, dining in, cooking, going places. I, to this day, use with my friend Stephanie Webster, girl, you got 1 minute to take a picture of that pie because I don't have time to wait, which I got from you.
Yeah, the clock is definitely on.
Yes. So how did you come up with this idea to do etiquette? Is it ever okay to ... when it comes to the culinary world?
Well, I love reading etiquette columns. And to me, it's just purely for entertainment. And something I tell people a lot is like etiquette columns have existed for so long and people only seem to be behaving worse. So they're not working. So I get kind of the freedom to have a little fun with it. To me, it seems like nobody's listening to me anyway, so I kind of say whatever pops into my head, and I usually am in a pretty weird mindset.
Yeah, me too. I do the same thing. I just say whatever is in my brain, which is part of the reason why I didn't do very well in etiquette in culinary school, which is ironic because at culinary school, I graduated from the Culinary Institute of America, and there is a lot of etiquette taught in your classes at school, which, you know, I didn't realize till after the fact. And it's amazing how, I guess, when people talking about formal dining and things like that, that's where this etiquette is taught.
Well, the rules are so outdated when it comes to dining, too. Everything's so stuffy, and it definitely feels there are no rules anymore, so maybe we can just make them up.
So basically, you're saying if someone serves me a dish as a chef for 25 years, if I don't like it, it is okay for me to throw it at them.
See, now I'm wondering if maybe that's not okay.
Well done.
I think when it comes to violence, maybe not.
I started this by saying that I'm a huge fan of yours, in part because you have such a specific voice whereby you answer these questions with just enough snark to make people laugh, but then also take a step back and say, you know what, maybe I shouldn't talk about politics at the dining room table. So where does that come from? Where do you get that balance of understanding the nuances of how we eat and what we eat and being in these social settings, but at the same time infuse it with this really sharp humor, I think, that disarms people?
I think this is maybe a bad thing in some circumstances, but I'm pretty non-confrontational. I think that's at the core of all my answers. So I'm not gonna be the one who throws the dish in your face. Maybe there's a time and a place for being confrontational, like, you know, if you're talking to Congress or something. But, you know, a lot of times, like with your uncles, it's like, you're only going to get so far. So I think that's where I'm coming from. I also have good editors who keep me from going overboard. I think sometimes they're like, scale it back. You guys don't see that version of them, which is probably for the best.
Well, I have lots of questions. So, Alex, if someone serves me a plate of food with what we call a non-functional garnish, that sprig of rosemary that on the plate for no reason.
I love that.
That piece of thyme that I'm going to put a kale leaf for no reason on your plate. Is it okay then to throw that plate on the floor?
Is it glass plate or like melamine?
No, I mean, we're in the middle of a pandemic. It's probably a paper plate.
And I guess you could throw that on the floor. I wouldn't want to break glass.
Marisol, I'm checking that one. That's an okay. So that's good.
I love a non-functional garnish.
I love you, Alex.
No, stop.
I love you.
Perpetuating the problem.
I think
no.
It's sort of postmodern. It's like, this is food that you don't eat on the food that you do eat, but it's like blows your mind. I like that.
So I'm looking at your latest column. Is it ever okay to skip Thanksgiving altogether? That's the title. Advice for Thanksgiving gatherings, small and very small, from Alex Beggs. One of them says, and I'm glad someone asked this, we need an answer once and for all. What time should the Thanksgiving meal be served? Love, horological hell. So tell our listeners what you came up with, but then I have a follow-up.
You should serve Thanksgiving at dinner time.
I agree.
It is dinner. It is not lunch. And it's definitely not whatever meal exists at 3 p.m., which I'm pretty sure is tea time, and Thanksgiving is not tea time. But that said, you can kind of do whatever you want this year because hopefully you're staying home. You can be free. You can eat whenever your stomach desires. Order takeout. My Aunt Mary, shout out to Aunt Mary, is making fried chicken. I think as long as you're making it a Thanksgiving to remember and not because you infected your entire extended family.
And I agree. My sister wants to have Thanksgiving at like 3 o'clock. And I'm like, no, pretty sure.
It's dinner.
Way too early.
It's too early.
These questions that are so fantastic that appear in your column are always, you give them, I don't know if it's you giving the moniker, and that's my question. So this question was from Horological Hell. There's Jumble Jojo, Mystified Madison. Who is coming up with these monikers?
I have a Google Doc that is all the names that I make sure I don't repeat any. But I get a lot of questions on Instagram, so I try and use people's real names. If it's a name we've already run or I can't think of an adjective, although I almost always can, I'll make up a name for them. But I would say almost like 80% of the time, the name is someone's real name and the adjective is me searching thesaurus.com.
You're an English teacher's dream. I just want to put that out
there. It's impressive. It's really, really impressive. All right, Alex, I got just another question really quick. Mm-hmm. Let's say someone serves me a shrimp dish.
Are we talking about Thanksgiving?
Sure.
I love shrimp cocktail on Thanksgiving.
Me too. But they want me to eat it with a fork, right? So it's a shrimp dish with the tails on it. To me, those tails count as non-functional garnish. It's going on the floor.
I'm sensing a theme here, and I'm going to let you do you.
See?
It sounds like you've got to work some stuff out. You don't like a little shrimp tail? Sometimes they get nice and crispy.
Not with the fork.
They're edible.
I'm just trying to learn and take notes here. Sorry. Minus all, I apologize.
It came to the wrong source
here. I have a checklist. That's all.
Alex, I know this might have been last year. The etiquette was if you didn't cook the meal, you at least have to do something like wash the dishes. You know, never ask the host, what can I bring? So as the host, whether you're doing it via Zoom or just for your immediate family, is it okay to say, yes, Titi Jenny. You have an Aunt Mary, I have a Titi Jenny. You can bring a Cabernet, but it needs to be this Cabernet, this specific thing. Or is that so rude?
I've asked people to bring Bounty Select-A-Size paper towels, and I was very specific about the Select-A-Size. I like that one a lot. I don't know. I can't speak for all of humanity, but I find it productive to give them that specific. I think with wine, it's a little harder because, you know, every wine store is a little different from the next. I do have a kind of charmingly controlling friend who will give her local wine store the list of wines for guests to come and pick up so they can just walk in and be like, I'm going to so-and-so's house. What are the wines? I thought that was a good idea.
You make a registry at your wine store. Yes.
You can
this
do that.
This is amazing. Thanksgiving registry. I love it for any event.
And it's just all wine. So yeah, give them the specific instructions. I think within the realm of possibility, I think Bounty Select-A-Size is definitely a reasonable ask.
A lot of people are opting for the Zoom Thanksgiving this year, but I have a very big extended family, so I had to ask Alex, is it ever okay to opt out of the Zoom Thanksgiving?
No one wants to do a Zoom Thanksgiving. It's just torture. Zoom is for conference calls, and holidays are not conference calls. I think, you know, you need to check in with your family however you do that. I'm still kind of a phone family, so I'm sure I'll call my dad and my siblings and my great aunt and say, like, hi, what you cooking? Happy Thanksgiving, love you, bye. But like a 30-minute to several hour long Zoom Thanksgiving is not going to be fun for anyone. The technical difficulties, yelling over each other is just chaos. It is nightmare. Don't do it. Yeah.
You do offer some alternatives. Go for a long and lonely hike with a thermos of soup and your thoughts. I like this. I will take that over avoiding talking about the election with my family that disagrees with me any day of the week.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully you're celebrating Thanksgiving with your household and not joining with others indoors. It's just like a terrible idea. And then there's so many other things you can do. You can go for a long and lonely walk. I think I wrote that you could light a pumpkin spice candle and summon your ancestors. I've once spent a Thanksgiving watching all of the Friends Thanksgiving episodes. It was time really well spent. I think the John Wick movies are also appropriate for any holiday. That would be a good way to spend your time. Mm-hmm. Sell some old furniture on Facebook Marketplace. Find something that you thought was lost. Get into quilting. There's so much you could do.
We could start a Zoom friendship bracelet club.
Zoom anything. I don't want to do. Okay.
Well, what's the plan for at your house for Thanksgiving? How are you guys changing and what's going to be different for you?
Well, we'd had to tell my in-laws that no, we didn't feel comfortable enough to come over. It just felt too risky. So that's kind of a hard conversation to have. But ultimately, as long as your family understands that this is a highly infectious global pandemic, they're understanding. So if they don't, then maybe your problems are bigger than I'm capable of solving. So we're staying in, and I'm not sure what I'm going to cook yet. I think in the column I wrote, I'm boiling lobsters, and I've done that before. It's kind of extravagant. Anything other than turkey, you know, I like maybe duck confit could be cool feeling, fancy, festive. I think a roast chicken.
Well, those all sound great. That's awesome. I can't wait to see it on Zoom with you. Just kidding. Alex isn't coming to my Zoom Thanksgiving. I did invite her, though. She politely declined.
That was Alex Beggs. She writes the Is It Ever Okay column in Bon Appetit magazine.
Seasoned is produced by Robin Doyen-Aiken and Katie Talarski. All of us at the show wish you a memorable, happy Thanksgiving. Whether you Zoom or not, I'm Chef Plum.
And I'm Marisol Castro. Thanks so much for listening.